Okay, good morning, everyone. While you're settling in, last time we started with a riddle. This morning, let's begin with considering the sea squirt, a very small marine animal that spends the juvenile stage, the first part of its life, swimming about the ocean. And at some point, when it starts to mature into an adult, it finds a convenient rock face, connects to that rock face permanently, and then, who knows the story of the sea squirt?
It digests its own brain.
It digests its own brain, not unlike some of my colleagues who have received tenure. Okay, academic humor, it's not for everyone. There you go. We are investigating in lectures 11 and 12, sort of an unspoken assumption underlying most of those who work in robotics, which is that locomotion undergirds cognition. Everything that we do that makes us think that we're so intelligent, you can either directly or indirectly trace it back to the fact that the way we view the world is like this. Pretty much everything we do or we experience in the first years of our life have to do with us moving ourselves to useful things and away from not so useful things. Everything else is built on top of it. Later in the spring, we're going to actually look at some of these, traces or vestiges that are left over in abstract cognition that sort of hint at the fact that cognition is rooted in locomotion. When you're struggling with a difficult concept, you either tell yourself or someone tells you to dig in, to lean into it. If I check in with you and see how you're doing with the assignments, you might say you're making progress, you're getting through it. Even in our language, there are leftovers of this idea that cognition is rooted in locomotion. So, in lectures 11 and 12, we're not really going to see much about cognition. We're really going to look at what exactly does locomotion mean, and why is it so difficult, and what are all the different ways in which organisms get themselves from point A to point B, and which of those mechanisms might we want to build into machines to allow them to get from point A to point B, and then start to layer more and more intelligent behavior on those self-displacing machines. Yeah, just a reminder of where we are and where we're going. Okay, logistics for a moment. As you can see here in all caps, I will not be here next week. I'm going to be traveling to the UK. Please be sure to be here on Tuesday the 19th. I will have something good for you to eat in repayment for letting me slip away next week. So we will not see each other in person for almost 3 weeks. I suggest you use this time, if you've started to fall behind on the assignments, to reach out to the TA, to me, figure out what's going on, get caught up so that we're all back on the same page when we get back here on the 19th.
Can I ask what the conference is? Like, what are you doing?
What the conference is. I am going to a workshop at the University of Cambridge next week on embodied AI. Pretty much all these things we've been talking about. As we're going to talk about actually after spring break, we're going to get into some of these open problems in the field. That's exactly what we're going to be discussing in the UK next week. Okay.
I have an idea for a final project, but
yep.
I don't know how difficult
yep.
it would be.
Good point.
So,
okay.
I was wondering if I could just like throw it at you. I could throw it at you after class.
Yeah, don't throw it at me now.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely throw it at me after class. Great point. So some of you are starting to get near to or already thinking about or have already started your final project. It's very difficult to have a good intuition for what's too easy, what's too hard. Absolutely. Come and see me or the TA. Contact us on Teams. Shoot us an email. I would be more than happy to at least help you estimate or ballpark what's reasonable with the time that we have left. Yes, absolutely. Any other questions or comments? Okay. All right. So let's see. So a few things I do want to mention while we're still all here together in person. Undergrads, you're working on assignment 7. Grads, you're working on differentiable assignment 2, which is the implementation of springs, sort of the equivalent of rotational joints in the non-differentiable assignments. And then next Tuesday, when I'm not here, A8 will drop for the undergrads, and D3 will drop for the grads. Again, I will not be here. If you need me, Teams me, email me, and I will get back to you asynchronously next week. Yeah? Okay. And then you've got either A8 or D3 to wrestle with for 2 weeks over spring recess, and then everything will be due the Monday we come back over spring recess. Don't ruin your spring recess by leaving everything until the last few days, and you got to spend the last part of your spring recess doing evolutionary robotics. Spread things out. Okay. All good? Okay, enough logistics. Back to the good stuff. We are going to dive back in to our lecture on legged locomotion, or the roots of locomotion in cognition. Okay, we ended last time by making this very important point that there is no optimal way on this planet or any planet to get from point A to point B for simple physical, or more specifically, biomechanical reasons. Any way in which an organism or a machine chooses to move from point A to point B is that machine or organism trying to strike a balance between displacement, robustness, energy, and stability. We'll probably get to bipedal locomotion today, our particular way of getting from point A to point B, in which we strike a very extreme version of this trade-off. What is it? We're really good at this one, not so good at these other ones. There are many organisms out there that are way faster than us. The mountain goat is pretty good at scaling cliffs. We are not so good. And it takes us years to figure out how to move on two legs without falling over. Okay. All right, we were talking about Alexander's book last time and looking at just the table of contents, which is all the ways in which Mother Nature has discovered to move animals from point A to point B. We're going to spend a few minutes now looking at some of the figures from that book. First of all, in the study of animal locomotion, how do we know how animals are striking a trade-off between displacement, energetics, and so on? Easiest way to do that is to expose them or challenge them to move at different speeds, for example, putting them on a treadmill, and then instrumenting them with some technology that's measuring how much energy they're using per unit time to move at that speed. Yeah. Has anybody ever done any actual VO2 max experiments? Yeah, relatively an easy thing to do with humans as well. One of the first things that was learned when this technology was first deployed is that you get some interesting relationships between speed, for example. So let's look at this plot in the lower left. We've got speed of travel in meters per second and the total amount of energy required to move at that speed. Again, I apologize if you're in the back of the room. This might be hard to read. This left-hand curve corresponds to human walking for the average adult human. What is this curve telling us about human walking for most of us?
It usually doesn't exceed 2 meters per second.
Because? Why don't we walk at 2 meters per second? Or above 2 meters per second? You can.
It takes a lot more.
It takes a lot more power. It takes exponentially more power. As you walk at a given speed, if you then start walking at twice that speed, it requires more than twice as much energy to do so. There is a diminishing return as you accelerate this particular gait. So we're going to spend a bit of time now in legged locomotion talking about different gaits. This is pretty obvious, I think, to us. There's certain patterns of movement that feel comfortable to the animal, including these animals in this room. Walking is defined as the fact that at least one foot is on the ground at any one time. Running is when there is a period during the gait in which all feet are off the ground. For humans, more or less, there are these two gaits.
Do you know if running eventually becomes exponential, like as the speed keeps increasing, or is it like always linear?
after class. Don't do it on the ice, but find somewhere comfortable to sprint at your top speed. Absolutely, if you keep going, this curve becomes exponential, yeah? You cannot keep up your top speed for very long for exactly this reason. Yes, I think actually even this is probably an approximation. It's not quite flat, yeah? Okay. When does it feel comfortable? When does it feel uncomfortable to walk and it feels more comfortable to switch to running?
When you're at that intermediate speed, where they're overlapping.
Absolutely, right? The reason it feels comfortable at a certain speed, if you're on a treadmill and you slowly keep turning up the speed of that treadmill and you're walking on that treadmill, at some point it's going to feel increasingly uncomfortable because your body is telling you you're moving in an energy inefficient manner, and there's gonna be an increasingly felt urge to switch to trotting and then running. For our purposes, we'll assume they're the same for exactly this reason. So even in an individual animal, like humans, in which we've struck a particular balance between the four desiderata of self-displacement, there also we can switch a little bit between these different desiderata, but it's not a continuous thing. It's a discrete thing. Humans tend not to walk and half run, half walk, and fully run. We switch between these gates discreetly because of the nature of the energetics of legged locomotion. Make sense? That's why there are two gates. When you count the number of gates for us or for a horse or for whatever it is, Your count is an integer, not a float, not how much they're at one gate or at another. We switch discreetly between them because of this. You might remember our discussion last week about active categorical perception. The world is more or less continuous, but when we reach out and start to manipulate objects, suddenly categories seem to appear out of nowhere. Rollable, not rollable. Here's another example of that phenomenon happening. Your relationship with the outside world is continuous, but as you interact with it, all of these things, movement, body size, body mass, fitness, your level of fitness, energetics, what you ate, what you drank over the last few days, all come together and cause this to happen. These discrete felt patterns of experience. It feels comfortable to move at this gate, and now it feels comfortable to move at this gate. And stuff in between doesn't feel comfortable. Here is the emergence of discrete categories, once again, in the domain of locomotion. Remember, this discussion and the next discussion are all about how locomotion somehow provides a foundation for cognition. A big part of cognition that we've seen several times now in this course is categorization. Being able to distinguish friend from foe, food from poison, and so on. Here is possibly one of the origins of categorization. Okay. All right, here's another plot. Again, there's a lot of interesting things that go on with legged locomotion, so I can't resist sharing some of these figures with you. Here's another one where they put humans on a treadmill and asked for a given speed of the treadmill. So now on the horizontal axis, we no longer have speed, we have a fixed speed. They asked humans to move at different stride frequencies. So a stride frequency of 1 hertz means something is repeating every 1 second, which in this case is this. You can try this today. Pay attention as you're walking. For most of us, walking at 1 hertz feels very comfortable. There are some particularly tall folks here in the room. For the taller folks, it's not quite 1, it's a little bit less. And for the shorter stature among us, it's a little bit more than 1 hertz. But generally speaking, 1 hertz. What happens when you don't walk at 1 hertz? What's happening out here?
You're either like increasing the stride length to a point where it isn't efficient, or you're shortening it to a point where like it you're spending more energy on like kind of the turnover than you are actually moving yourself forward.
Good point. So there's two possibilities that are happening out here. Remember, these are humans on a treadmill. The treadmill is fixed at a certain speed, and the human subjects are being asked to walk at more than 1 hertz. So what's happening? Which of those two conditions is it? Lots of little fast, small steps. You can again try this at home without anybody watching you because it looks silly, and you'll start to break into a sweat before long. What's happening back here?
Overstriding,
right? So this is very long strides, which also feels uncomfortable because you have to start using exponentially more energy to do so. It doesn't show how fast they're moving. The speed is set to, what should it be? It's probably about 1.5 meters per second, I'm gonna guess. The bottom of this curve is comfortable walking. Put someone on a treadmill, people tend to walk at 1 hertz, set the rate of the treadmill to about 1 meter per second, and down here they're walking and feeling perfectly comfortable. Make sense? Why does it take more energy when you're walking at one, let's say 1 meter per second? Why does it take more energy to take lots of small steps or few very long, or take very long strides to walk at less than 1 hertz? What's going on? Why is it so energy efficient at 1 hertz? More muscle activation to support your weight. That's kind of true because you're taking longer.
And then for the shorter one, because you have to halt your momentum on each step.
You got the right idea, right? You're using more of the muscles in your legs at these two extrema. The genius of human bipedal locomotion is that the moment your back leg leaves the ground, all of the muscles in what's now called the swing leg, because that leg is about to swing, all the muscles in that leg go limp, and your leg becomes a what? Becomes a pendulum. Your leg swings forward, not because you're exerting energy through the muscles to push your leg forward. It's momentum. It will just carry it forward. And the moment your swing leg hits the ground, the moment your heel hits the ground, you tense your muscles and you allow the weight of your body to rock over what's now called your stance leg, while your other leg is getting about a half second of rest. Remember, we're walking at 1 hertz here, 1 step per second, more or less. So during every second that you walk, one of your legs is on break for 50% of the time. Very energy efficient.
Across like all of the people studied, do people have like different like walking economy, or is everyone about the same level of like efficient in their walking?
Good question. Absolutely not. So people have different energy efficiency. Good athletes tend to walk more efficiently, not just because they're in good shape, but because their brains are highly tuned to pay attention to when to relax the muscles. High-level athletes, that's actually what they're learning to do over years and decades, is energy efficiency. Know exactly when to use which muscle group under which condition. And for a lot of athletes, that tends to bleed into the things that we tend to do normally, which is walking. But this variation is small because regardless of whether you're an Olympic athlete or a couch potato, you still have to spend decades of your life moving around, mostly using walking. We've got years and years of experience of doing it, and whether you're aware of it or not, and you're probably not aware of it, you spend a lot of that time tuning or training your muscles to relax on the off, on the swing step. Yes, Emily. Absolutely. So good point, right? So there are certain things that go on in a lot of musical traditions around the world that seem to relate back to 1 hertz or 2 hertz. Seems like quite a coincidence. There are a lot of natural rhythms in the brain as well. There are a lot of different frequencies at work in the brain. One of the loudest frequencies in the brain, one of the more common frequencies you're used by neurons and brain regions, is what frequency? 1 hertz. Sounds like a big coincidence again. Okay. Okay. We're going to talk about bipedal locomotion in more detail in the next lecture. Let's focus on legged locomotion in general. I've already anticipated a lot of this, so here we go. Any horse people here? Kind of? Okay, all right. So there are a number of gaits for four-legged animals. Let's pick on the horse for a while. We just talked about stance phase and flight phase. So regardless of the legged locomotion, or the regardless of the animal species or the machine that we're talking about, if it's walking on legs, we can identify the different gaits or the way that it moves based on things like, for example, stance phase. So over the span of a cycle of the gait. So for bipeds, if I start with my right leg, finish here, and I'm about to start with my right leg again, that's one gait cycle. Right, left. Yeah. Depending on the animal and depending on the gait, there may be more steps, but we can think about a gait cycle as the time it takes until that gait is about to repeat. And we can look at the time span of that single gait cycle and ask, is there a stance phase, or how long is the stance phase? How long during that cycle is there a period in which at least one foot is on the ground? And is there or is there not a flight phase in which there are no feet on the ground? In the case of the horse, there was an argument for a very long time about whether trotting actually had a flight phase or not. If you watch a horse, if you get on Google, if you get on YouTube and watch trotting horses and try and pay attention, it's very hard to see it. So Edvard Muybridge over 100 years ago said, let's solve this once and for all. I'm going to make a little piece of technology that's going to capture an image of the horse at this point in time, and then a short period of time later, and a short period of time later. And then I'm going to take all of those images and put them together and watch them one after the other, but slowly, so we can answer this question once and for all. Is there a flight phase during trotting? And that result was the very first movie ever created. Okay, little piece of trivia for you. Okay. Here's six gaits for a greyhound type dog. Stance phase, flight phase, yes, no, which ones?
So this is the bottom three have flight phases, top three don't.
Bottom three, yes, top three, no. Pace, it's a little hard to see. Beautiful diversity in the ways in which four-legged animals can move. So depending on how you count, there's sort of six gaits for very fast-moving dogs. For horses, how many gaits are there?
Nine.
I see three, I see nine. It's tricky. Depends on which horse species we're talking about. Anybody heard of tulting before? You'll have to pardon my Icelandic pronunciation. Again, this lecture is filled with lots of good YouTube references. Go check out tulting after class. Particular breed of Icelandic horse has six. Most other species of horse, only five. Okay, let's introduce some more terminology that'll be helpful when we talk about locomotion in general and bipedal locomotion in the next lecture. Remember that one of the four desiderata in legged locomotion is stability. Moving on upright legs is useful because it can be energy efficient rather than dragging your belly across the ground, but it comes at a cost, which is stability. There's the danger that you might fall down. Let's talk a little bit more in depth about what exactly we mean by stability. There is static stability, which is sort of the stronger version of stability. The static stability operationally, so the way you test it operationally, is that if you're in a particular gait and that movement stops at any point in time, you do not fall over. It's a good way to move. if stability is important. You're going over ice, you're moving over potentially thin ice, scree, pebble fields, whatever it is. It's important if something goes wrong that you're able to pause, stop, assess, and then keep going, literally. Dynamic stability is a little bit different. Dynamic stability means you may not have static stability. It means if you stop at any one point in time, you might fall over. But dynamic stability means that even if you're perturbed, if something unexpected happens, while you're in this dynamically stable gait, you're able to recover. Human running is not statically stable. Why not? Absolutely. If you freeze your motion, especially when you're in your flight phase, the part of the gait in which both feet are off the ground, things are not going to end well for you, right? Human running is statically stable, but for most of us, if you're a pretty good runner, you're statically stable. If you can catch a ball in mid-flight and keep going, you can deal with perturbations as you go. Okay. How do we know operationally, we know if someone or something is statically stable, if movement stops and the animal will not fall over. Why? We can actually look at the polygon of support and the center of mass of the animal or machine at that time. Again, you can do this experiment at home. As you're walking around in a normal way, think about or feel the pressure of the ground on the soles of your feet. If you think about it, when your feet are both on the ground, that describes a particular polygon known as the polygon of support. The moment you take one of your feet off the ground, you'll feel that you tend to shift your weight up and over that foot so that even if you stop, you don't fall over. As long as your center of mass is over your polygon of support, you are statically stable, more or less. Depends on momentum and speed, but generally speaking, if you want to keep stable, this is the way to do it. Keep your center of mass over your polygon of support. Most quadrupeds have a pretty big polygon of support when all four feet are on the ground. The minute they take a foot off the ground, there's a triangle of support. If they take off the front right and the back left, it's like our walking. It's a little less stable, but still possible. Walking around on two or four legs is sort of a good strategy because you can easily tune the area, the surface area of your polygon of support. You can make it very large and be very stable as you walk, or you can make it very small and be very agile. It gives you lots of opportunities. Okay, so here's statically stable. The moment a quadruped, like a horse, for example, is only standing on its left front and left back leg, it's statically unstable. It's going to fall over, in this case, to its right, unless it shifts its center of mass over its left-hand side. The polygon of support is trivial to calculate. As long as you have the animal moving over a force plate. Actually, there's a world-class lab for this over in the College of Rehabilitation there, the nursing and rehabilitation, I forget what it's called. They've got a great system. There's a big lab up there with a very highly sensorized floor where you can get all of this information at about a tenth of a second. Yeah. Okay. Okay, one last look at some quadrupedal animals before we push on. I love this figure 4.3 here. In this particular experiment carried out in the 80s, a bunch of researchers trained some ponies to move at different speeds. Ponies tend to have three gaits: walking, trotting, and galloping. And the black bars that you see down here are observations of ponies in their natural habitat doing whatever ponies do. Some of the time they walk around slowly, sometimes they get a little bit frisky and trot around, and from time to time when they're actually moving, they're moving with this gait at about this speed. They took these ponies and put them on very big treadmills and turned up and turned down the speed of the treadmill to train these ponies to walk at speeds they don't normally walk at, trot at speeds they don't normally trot at, and gallop at speeds they don't normally gallop at. How do you think they trained the ponies to do this? The ponies don't really want to do this. Rewards such as tasty snacks, absolutely, right? So at some point in the experiment, if they want the ponies to walk slower than feels comfortable for the pony, give them a snack if they move a little bit slower, more of a snack, and so on. Huge effort went into this particular data set, often not really appreciated. What happened? Oh, and obviously they had masks on the ponies and were measuring the amount of carbon dioxide and oxygen that was being exchanged so they could detect how much energy the ponies were using per meter, per unit of displacement.
They were getting tired much quicker, so it took a lot more time to do this experiment?
It took a lot of time to do this experiment. These poor ponies certainly put in a fair bit of effort to do this.
So walking and trotting kind of have minima where it's pretty apparent.
Absolutely, yep.
What's optimal, where is galloping, kind of seems, it probably isn't actually asymptotic, but they can just kind of keep galloping for at higher speeds for a similar energy level.
True, they cut it off here. I would imagine that if you kept going and turned up the treadmill more on these ponies, it's gonna start spiking pretty quickly. Yeah, same for humans. So what a surprise. The natural speed that these quadrupeds like to travel at is exactly at the speeds of their energy minima. Maybe not so surprising in retrospect, but again, I think this is a really important point to make. There are complicated trade-offs in the way that anyone or anything moves from point A to point B, and all of the animals on this planet, we have evolved to move at exactly those speeds, and it takes quite a bit to convince us to do otherwise. Okay. That's no good. That's really no good. Okay. Sorry, everyone. Okay, spent a lot of time talking about legged animals in this class so far. There's one particular legged animal that always makes its way into any biomechanics discussion. Okay, a very exceptional form of legged locomotion on land. The one particular species or genus that is an exception to every rule, here it is. What trade-off is the octopus striking here between displacement, energetics, robustness, and stability?
Isn't this more of it can technically do it, but it's super suboptimal?
It's super suboptimal, absolutely. Why is it doing it to begin with? Better than the alternative. Better get back to water. Okay. Anyways. Okay. The octopus is always the exception. Any discussion about animal behavior, the octopus is always the exception. Okay, we spent a lot of time talking about animals. This is a robotics class, so back to robots. We're going to take, or roboticists try to take, what we can learn about the various trade-offs between these four desiderata and build them into machines. What's that buzzing sound? What about the motors? Not all motors make that sound. These motors are working pretty hard. What is that buzzing sound? Why are the motors buzzing, aside from the fact that they're working pretty hard?
Is it like friction? Are they like doing resistance stuff?
It's not so much the motors themselves that's making the buzzing sound. Gears getting closer. Is it the resistance of the motors? That might be part of the sound.
It's gas powered.
Aha, yeah. Diesel engine on board this thing. Which is an immediate hint about the particular trade-off between the Ford Desiderata that this machine is making. This is the big dog robot. This video dropped in 2005, and this was sort of the... this was a sea change in robotics. The moment this video dropped, everything changed.
Is it sort of like forced to be extremely stable and like forced into this like sort of gate? And I mean, it's probably maximizing stability so that it can deal with these different environments, but the like energy consumption is just through the roof.
That's exactly it. This machine was designed very, very carefully with massive people hours put into it to maximize stability and robustness. The actual ground that this robot is moving over might look more or less uniform to you, but from the robot's perspective and from a roboticist's perspective in 2005, this robot is experiencing very different situations from moment to moment. Big dog never enters the same river twice. For a legged, especially a legged robot, it is experiencing unique situations all the time. This is big dog slipping on the ice. Big dog is actually carrying 325 pounds in those packs. Do not try this at home. Do not load up your backpack with 325 pounds and slip on the ice. I did not tell you to do that. Why would they do that? Why would they load this thing up with 325 pounds and demonstrate that it can recover from slipping on ice?
That's what they're going to use it for.
The camouflage on the pouches is a pretty strong hint about who Boston Dynamics is trying to impress with this video. It's not the public. Although the public was very impressed when this came out.
Is this like deep learning? Like is this thing like explicitly programmed or is it doing?
So this is a machine made by a company. And as you can imagine, that company is very possessive about the secret sauce. I can tell you a little bit. This is definitely this is not using a deep neural network at the time, although deep neural networks were known at that time. It's using a particular algorithm in which the robot realizes that something's happened. Its leg or the angle of the joints in its leg are not what they should normally be. It's starting to sink into the mud, and it very quickly dreams up a way of moving to bring that leg back where it should be. Imagine we look at just two joints. Okay, I know this video is very addictive. Imagine we look at the angle of just two joints in the robot, the angle in one of the legs, the angle of the knee and the angle of the hip, let's say. You think about your knee and your hip while you're walking. If we were to plot the angle of your knee and the angle of your hip at a given point in time, let's say those two angles are this, at the next time step, the angles are this, then at the next time step, the angles are this, this should be starting to look familiar. What diagram are we drawing?
A phase
diagram. When you're walking normally, comfortably, and we watch the angle of your knee and hip over time, what is this diagram gonna look like? It's going to repeat like this, right? We have a cyclic gait. The moment, same thing for Big Dog. The moment somebody comes in and kicks Big Dog, this happens. What does Big Dog do at that time? All of the smarts in here is to figure out how to bring this trajectory back to here as quickly as possible. You can't read about the details of this. If you're interested, come and see me and we can talk about it. The mathematics is pretty ferocious, but this was the innovation. How do you get back to your cyclic attractor, this thing that attracts cyclic things, as quickly as possible when you're pushed outside of your comfort zone, literally? That was the innovation that took years to perfect, that was then built into this machine, and this video was dropped, and robotics changed forever after this point. You can see a flight phase there in Big Dog's running slash galloping. Here's a demonstration of the fact that it's maximizing, or it's prioritizing robustness. Big Dog can walk over very different kinds of environments. Okay, so that's Big Dog. Some very dramatic examples of dynamic stability. Big Dog, in a lot of cases, if it actually stops moving, will fall over. It's not statically stable, but as you saw, it's pretty dynamically stable. Okay, I'm gonna show you one more video. So this was Big Dog released in about 2005. Shortly afterward, another video dropped demonstrating Big Dog Beta. What is the innovation of Big Dog Beta over Big Dog Alpha? Pretty dynamically stable, not bad, huh? Let's see that again in slow-mo. Not bad. Two bipeds, worse than one biped alone. Okay, that's Big Dog Beta. All right. Okay, so we spent a bit of time looking at the biomechanics of locomotion in nature, and now we're trying to bring this back to technology. So if you will permit me, the rest of this lecture is taken from a paper I wrote a very long time ago now, when I got interested in legged locomotion when I was a grad student. And in this case, I wanted to look at how different machines strike a balance between these four desiderata of locomotion as a function of their body plans. As we just saw when we looked at octopi and horses and dogs and humans and Big Dog, the way you're built strikes different trade-offs between these four. That fact was known, but I wanted to dig into the details. How exactly does having more legs, having less legs, being closer to the ground, being further away from the ground, how does that influence the trade-offs? So I came up with the following experiment. I created by hand, no evolution yet, I created these 10 different body plans. So these robots all have very different bodies. But then I tried to make everything else about these 10 different, these morphologically different robots the same. Each one of these 10 robots has exactly 4 touch sensors. It's got exactly 4 angle sensors, and it's got exactly 8 motors. I apologize, you're probably not going to be able to see this on the slide. I went through and labeled where all the M's are, where all the 8 motors are, where all the 4 A's are, the 4 angle sensors, and where all the 4 T touch sensors are. By making sure that each of these 10 robots has exactly 8 sensors, 4 angles, 4 touches, and exactly 8 motors, I could also make the neural controllers for all 10 robots identical. So these robots have different bodies, same brains. Here's the 4 touch sensors up here. Here's the 4 angle sensors up here. 8 motor neurons down here. I threw in 3 hidden neurons and some recurrent and self-connections in case these robots need short-term memory in order to locomote. And I threw in two additional neurons called B1 and B2. We haven't actually talked about these type of neurons yet. Anybody know, or can anybody guess what these are? What the B stands for?
General biases.
The B stands for bias. We actually saw this when we talked about CTRNNs. In this simpler case here, a bias neuron is always on. It just emits a value of 1. And the evolutionary algorithm is going to now evolve weights for all of these synapses, including the weights of the synapses that go from this bias neuron to the hidden neurons, and from this bias neuron to these motor neurons. Why did I add in these two bias neurons in this particular study of locomotion?
You want to make sure it's actually moving and not just standing still.
I want to make sure that it's easier for evolution to make sure that these machines are always moving. Imagine the robot happens to get into a situation where it's in the flight phase. All 4 feet or all 4 parts of its body that have the 4 touch sensors in it are off the ground, then all 4 touch sensors are firing with zeros. If the 4 angles happen to be at their default angle, which is 0, there's a possibility that the robot can suddenly get no incoming sensory information from the outside world. And there's recurrent connections here, so this complicates the story a little bit. But generally speaking, if you've got all zeros coming in and you're multiplying these zeros by non-zero synaptic weights, what are you likely going to get at the hidden layer, the output layer? 0, right? So the bias neuron here is just to help evolution make sure that the robot doesn't suddenly freeze in place. That's all.
My bias neuron, instead of having a bias parameter in the...
Because I was a grad student, didn't know any better at the time. An arbitrary choice. There are certainly things I would have done better if I were to do this all again. Absolutely. We could have just incorporated the bias term into the neurons themselves.
I was going to ask, did you like add that because it started freezing
midair? I did not. I knew that that was a possibility, so I just threw it in to be safe. I have no idea whether it was useful or not. Okay. All right. So what we're going to see in a moment, we're going to look at some data from this experiment. For each one of these robots, I created a population of sets of synaptic weights for this cognitive architecture and evolved neural controllers on this robot for hundreds of generations until at the end, I took the set of synaptic weights that moved this robot the furthest, the fastest, and set it aside, then rewound the evolutionary tape and ran it forward again for this robot, again and again and again, until I had a whole bunch of highly fit sets of synaptic weights. Sets of synaptic weights that if they were dropped into this network and this network was dropped back into this robot, it would move very quickly. I then went to the second robot and did the same thing all over again. Same amount of evolutionary effort for each of these 10 robots over and over and over again. The fitness function was simply the one that you're using in your assignments, maximize displacement. Move quickly, I don't care about energetics, I don't care about stability, just move. I don't condone gambling, but we're going to take a wager. Hands up if you think one evolved to move the fastest. Hands up if you think two evolved to move the fastest. Okay, one vote for two. Three, a couple more votes for three. Four, no votes. Five, all right, one vote for five. Six, six is a hexapod. It's a little hard to see from the figure. No votes for the hexapod. Going once, going twice. Seven, a couple votes for seven, okay. Eight, nine, a couple votes for nine. How about our tripod number 10? Thank you. A couple votes for 10. Okay, remember your vote. Okay, We are not looking at fitness yet. You cannot tell from looking at this graph which one moved the fastest. What you're looking at is, you're looking at 10 different footprint graphs. So let's talk about how to read a footprint graph. I took the number one most fit controller that I got for each of the 10 robots, which you see down here. So each of the 10 panels corresponds to how that robot moved when it was armed with the most fit controller. What does each row in each panel represent? Can you intuit it from this picture? Oh, it says on the plot. So this should be an easy question to answer. Each row corresponds to not necessarily a foot, because not every robot has a foot. It's some part of the body that comes into contact with the ground. Columns, there are 500 columns. Each column corresponds to one time step in the 500 time step simulation that I ran. What's going on? What do you see? There's a lot to see here.
They're all very different.
Yep.
They're all sort of periodic, but not exactly periodic.
They're not, there is a fair bit of periodicity, but it's not perfect. Could be. There's some hints. There's starting to be some hints now about who's doing well and who's not doing well. Number 10, you'll notice if we go back, is the tripod here. It tends to have a longer gait cycle. Here's the gait cycle. Starts here, and at about, after only about 90 time steps, does this particular robot start to repeat. Other robots have a much shorter gait cycle. So there's nothing in here, nothing in the fitness function that said you have to walk at 1 hertz or 2 hertz. Evolution figured it out for these different body plans. So I got excited when I saw this plot because I was already starting to learn something about the relationship between body plan and striking a balance between these different ways of moving. This particular body plan has a much longer, slower gait cycle than some of the others. Other observations?
Six has the longest, like, consistent gait between all of the different steps.
Okay.
Would that mean that it almost seems like it's leaping, though, because it's not alternating in, like, touch sensors touching the ground.
You'll notice in number six, which is the hexapod, yep, you tend to get vertically stacked black bars and then periods, short windows in which there are vertical bars of white. What do the vertical bars of white mean? What are they telling you about the gait? That's flight phase, right? Those are times during which all 6 feet are off the ground. Does anybody know what this particular gait is called? Pronking. Does anybody remember the old Looney Tunes character, Pepe Le Pew? Now I'm dating myself. The skunk? That's pronking, yeah? Okay, so the hexapod, at least in this case, evolved to pronk. A good sign, it's a recognizable gait. Pronking, pretty, not very energy efficient. Takes a lot of energy to do this, but you can actually pronk at a pretty fast speed. We can't, but there are species that can. Things look good. Anybody want to revise their bets here?
I guess that number six is probably the fastest.
Okay, we've got some votes switching to six.
I'm thinking eight.
You're thinking eight? Why are you thinking eight?
Cycle of, it's not simultaneous. There's like a little bit of like a cascading of it, but there's also flight time.
Okay, so there's a fair bit of flight time for eight. That's often a good sign for speed. Oh, not always. Here's another form of pronking that's not very fast, but yes. And then you get a cascade of footfalls, which maybe is indicative of faster speed. Maybe yes, maybe no. It's tricky. It's complicated. It's always complicated when we're talking about locomotion. Okay, should we keep going? Okay, more evidence for you. Again, I apologize for the quality of these 2002 videos. That's one of the better controllers for the hexapod. Here's one of the better controllers for the quadruped. It's a relatively rare quadrupedal gait in nature. It exists, but it's kind of rare. Here's our triped. Anybody spent any time on crutches? Kind of familiar, huh? Really struggling. It fell over right at the end. Why did it fall over right at the end? Aside from the fact that it's clearly not doing a very good job. Idea? Don't care about stability. The fitness function just says move as far as possible. The fitness function does not say and don't fall over at the end. It's perfectly fine, right? It kicks out its foot, probably got a few more fitness points for doing that. I don't remember exactly how I was calculating the fitness, but probably something like that. It's a little sort of whiff of perverse instantiation there. Okay, here's, I think this is 5 or 7. What's happening in this case? There's a wave. Sound familiar? Like a worm, like a caterpillar, like an earthworm, all of which exhibit what form of locomotion? Peristalsis, right? So here we go, artificial evolution, yet again rediscovering something that Mother Nature discovered billions of years ago. If you have a very long, more or less one-dimensional body plan, one good way to move is to establish traveling waves of motion along the length of your body, which exerts certain force against the ground or through a tunnel of dirt and allows forward travel. So I was excited when I saw this again, not necessarily a fast mode of travel, but again, the reappearance of a familiar gait from nature. Okay, given those four videos, anybody want to revise their bets again? You're going with 6. Okay, we have another defector to number 6. Okay, I've held you in suspense for long enough. Those of you that switched, voted for or switched your vote to number 6, good on you. You'll notice that 6 at the end, or sorry, okay, let's talk about the plot. So again, on the horizontal axis now, we're plotting evolutionary time. And on the vertical axis, we're plotting fitness, which in this case was equal to displacement. How far along the x-axis did the robot travel? You'll notice there's kind of some clustering here. 6 and 2 and 3 did quite well. The curve for 6 is a little bit bumpier than the other ones. It's because I ran out of time when I was doing this paper. I collected enough data for all 9, and I was collecting data for number 6 and didn't get as much. So I'm pretty sure 6 was the best, but we'll have to see. To be continued 21 years later. Questions?
So you said that you use the same controller for older robots?
This one, yes.
Which robot did you evolve the controller on?
So the cognitive architecture of the controller was the same for all 10 robots. Cognitive architecture is the number and distribution of of neurons and how they're wired up. But I evolved this cognitive architecture on all 10 of the robots. So each robot evolved different sets of synaptic weights. So strictly speaking, every robot that's plotted in this plot is actually armed with a different controller. All the robots have identical cognitive architecture, but different sets of synaptic weights, which is what evolution produced. Make sense? Okay. You'll see here 6, 2, and 3 did more or less equally well. Here's six, here's two, here's three. Now begins the hypothesis part of this experiment. Why? Let's generate some hypotheses. Why was the body plan of 6, 2, and 3 particularly easy for evolution to evolve fast travel for?
I feel like the morphologies are naturally pretty stable, so they get that kind of for free, and they can invest more into the displacement aspect.
I think so too, right? 6, 2, and 3, they're up off the ground, they've got vertically arranged legs so they can swing, and assuming they don't fall over and they orchestrate the movement of their vertically aligned legs, they can probably pick up a fair bit of steam. This one, number one, it's pretty stable, but it doesn't have the same vertical swing of the legs. Things get kind of hand wavy at this point because, again, things are complicated. Lots of different trade-offs here. The clear losers in this were 5 and 7. Why, do you think? Idea in the back?
They don't have like multiple legs that they can pick up multiple different times. They kind of have to inch forward.
They have to inch forward. This one, yes.
Yeah,
this one has vertical legs. Lots of vertical legs, actually.
They have no like horizontal.
Right, they've got no. Now, it's tricky to see in this picture, I apologize. The legs for the worms here are actually cylinders. And I made the legs cylinders so that these snakes, or this particular snake, cannot fall over to the left or the right. There's a small detail that's a little hard to see from this. So actually, number 7 is actually quite stable. It's also stable, has lots of vertically aligned legs, like 6 and 2 and 3, but it lost terribly. Why?
They don't have any, I'm just going to call it, extension along like this axis at all.
Okay.
So they can't leverage, like you were talking like the falling forward thing. They can't swing at all to move themselves. Yeah.
Maybe. It's hard to say. They do have vertical legs, so there's a lot of swing underneath. So maybe yes, but I think not. I don't think that's the reason why. Why is 7 doing so terribly?
A lot of contact with the ground.
A lot of contact with the ground, so they've got to kind of deal with that. There's the possibility that some of the legs, even if they're doing the right thing, are dragging along the ground. That's not so great. That's probably a bit of a drag, literally, on this machine. You got to do a whole wave. This controller has to figure out how to induce a traveling wave along the entire body, and then do it again, and do it again, and do it again. My guess, I never actually went back and tested this, that this particular cognitive architecture is good for orchestrating the movement of 4 swinging things, but not so good at orchestrating a traveling wave. This is probably the wrong cognitive architecture for this body, but maybe the right architecture, or at least a good cognitive architecture for this body. It's not that body is good or brain is good. There's a lot of that kind of argumentation going on in robotics and AI. As always, in reality, it's more complicated than that. It's about having the right combination of body and brain. At least that's the main message I took away from this experiment. Okay, let's have a look at one last plot. So I did try and tease out some of these relationships between body and brain. One question I asked is, maybe it's the total mass of the body that matters. So I'm just going to back up to the 10 robots for a moment. Each individual part here, each link, if you like, has a mass of 1. Again, in most physics engines, it's kind of unitless. These can be kilograms, pounds, it doesn't matter. You'll notice that these 10 different robots have more or less links. So the biggest one, which is number 6 here, has 41 different parts. Number 6 here, robot number 6 has 41 parts. Robot number 7 The upright snake has 39 parts. And number one back here, the first of the 10 robots, which was that simplified quadruped, only has 15 parts. So this robot is actually very light, and the hexapod is very heavy. So I rearranged the order of these 10 robots from lightest robot to heaviest robot. And then on the vertical axis, I plotted the fitness for that robot. How easy was it for evolution to get that robot to move fast? How fast did evolution get that robot to move? What do you see here?
There's like no correlation. It doesn't seem like being heavier decreases the performance at all because you didn't put any terms in there for like efficiency. They all have like unlimited energy they can use.
It kind of looks like there's a downward trend. It kind of looks like the heavier you are, the slower you move. But there's 1, 2, 3 out of 10 big exceptions. So yeah, probably no real relationship here between mass and displacement. Next thing I did was to take the 10 robots and reorder them again from the fewest points of contact they have with the ground. Here's robot number 10, the triped, which has 3 points of contact with the ground, all the way up to robots 5 and 7, which have 10, these are the 2 snakes. They each have 10 points of contact with the ground. Any relationship here?
Having between like 4 to 6 points of contact is the most natural for these robots?
Yeah, it looks like there's a Goldilocks phenomenon here, right? Not too few, not too many. If you've got too few points of contact, then you've got to struggle with stability. The evolutionary algorithm has to figure out how to move the triped quickly and not fall down. Not easy to do. Over here, the evolutionary algorithm has to wrestle with another problem here, which is it's got to orchestrate a lot of movement of a lot of things and keep them from dragging on the ground. So yes, it looks like there's a relationship here between points of contact and ability to evolve speed. The main takeaway I want you to take away from this is, as always, it's complicated. We started talking about legged locomotion, or locomotion in general, by talking about these 4 trade-offs. There's actually many, many more than 4. All sorts of things can impact your ability to move better or worse in different ways, at different speeds, under different conditions, being more or less stable, and so on and so forth. As Mother Nature was evolving mammals and starting to evolve legged locomotion, those challenges became more difficult, not just for Mother Nature, but for the animal involved, until you get our species, which requires years to figure out how to actually do that. If you can figure out how to move around on land, ice, all sorts of conditions without falling over, calculus and chess afterwards, piece of cake. The hard thing really is displacing with only 2 points of contact without falling over. Maybe, again, this is a hypothesis, maybe it's a lot easier to layer abstract cognition on top of an animal that's already really good at striking different balances between lots of very strictly competing desiderata. Maybe not just is locomotion a good foundation for intelligence, but maybe bipedal legged locomotion is a particularly good foundation on which to layer abstract cognition. Again, these are all hypotheses that have yet to be proven. Maybe some of you will make a dent in some of these problems. No pun intended. Okay. That took a little bit longer than I expected, so let's push on. And we'll spend 5 minutes talking about bipedal locomotion. We just finished saying that there are only 2 ways to move if you have 2 legs. Please tell me most of you recognize this video. I'm not that old yet. Okay. For those that haven't seen this video before, you're welcome. Okay, let's switch from biomechanics to political history. This is obviously takes place in London. There's Big Ben in the back. We have a British minister on his way to one of the government ministries. If you've ever spent any time in England wrestling with British government, there's a ministry for everything. So somewhere there must also be a ministry for silly walks, in which there are many ministers that walk with different silly gaits. Some of those gates are sillier than others. There's an infinite, this is just a reminder that there are an infinite number of ways to travel with only two legs. What do you think John Cleese's heart rate was at the end of this take? masterful acting. He doesn't break a sweat, at least during the take. But not so energy efficient, right? Okay. I wanted to show this video because I wanted to show this video. It'll also come back in a moment when we talk about the fitness function for this particular biped robot. Okay. All right. So we just looked at some human silly walks. Let's look at some robot silly walks. Before Big Dog and Atlas, the humanoid robot, Honda's Asimo robot was the undefeated champion of bipedal locomotion. Here it is. I'll just put this on loop. You're all laughing because it's a silly gait. Why is it silly? Looks like it's a 5-year-old. Which is actually a compliment, right? 5-year-olds are pretty smart. Why do 5-year-olds tend to walk like this?
More stability.
More stability, right? If you go down, you have less distance to travel. Why is Asimo walking like this? Now, a little bit of historical context. Sorry, it doesn't say it here. I think this is from the late 90s. So you got to think late 90s technology at this point. Sneaking, okay.
Because the feet are very, very flat.
Yeah, absolutely, right? It looks like a sneak or a scoot. That's not why Asimo is doing this. Yep, in the back there.
Well, it doesn't look like the feet are just flat.
Yep.
It doesn't look like there's any ability to absorb shock or anything. And so I think all of that force is going into the ankles and the knees. And so they need to be more bent and more flexible in order to absorb and make up for the
Good observation. So this gate was programmed by hand into this robot. It wasn't evolved or trained. One of the things the researchers wanted to do in this case was minimize the shock to the motors. Late 90s motors, not state of the art, were state of the art then. Yes, that was part of it.
If it's hand programmed, it's probably less robust, in which case having a lower center of gravity is going to make sure it's going to fall over.
Absolutely. So this particular robot and gait is very fragile, the opposite of robust, which it was very hard to program robustness in it. So if you're in danger of falling over, stay down close to the ground. And what else? Recall our discussion about legged locomotion over the last hour or so. Keeping its chest very vertical.
It's not leaning forward.
It's not leaning forward. These are all strong hints about the particular strategy of motion. It's staying low to the ground, keeping its chest vertical.
It's trying to stay statically stable.
It's statically stable. It's keeping its center of mass, it's keeping its vertical center of mass over its polygon of support at every moment in time. If you watch very carefully, they call this running. It's not running. There's no flight phase here. Looks like there is. There isn't. You can see Asimo is carrying a silver backpack. What do you think's in the silver backpack? Not weight. This is not 2005. They weren't able to show off yet. Actually, they were showing off. This was incredible when it was released.
Probably batteries and the whatever connection. Well, they could have been sending over the connection of the program since it's from a while ago.
They could have. The program was running on board. You said batteries and? Just batteries. This thing has a huge battery. It is. There's no flight phase. There's no exploiting the passive swing of the leg. No exploitation of the physics of the body. This gate was designed to override all of the natural dynamics of the body and force this particular very specific way of walking. There's a thing called the Asimo stairs. Honda designed a set of stairs to very precise measurements so that Asimo could actually walk up the stairs. I was in Japan years ago and saw an actual demonstration of this, and somebody scuffed one of the rungs of the stairs, and during the demonstration, Asimo got halfway up and was suddenly not so robust. Okay, you have a quiz due tonight. You're working on A7 or D3. Please watch the lectures online next week. Do not come to class next week. Enjoy spring recess. I'll see you the Tuesday after.